Hello. Hi. Guys, can I tell you the truth? This is like real life right here. Every once in a while, I have a problem with IT, with my computer, and I just went to unlock my computer to get my notes, and it wasn't working. But wait, maybe it will work in a second. We'll see. If not, I'm going to be working off of my phone today. Oh, here we go. Hey, it worked. Thank you, Lord. Here we go. Let me open this up. Guys, it is so good to be with you guys today. My name's Tim. As Luke said earlier, I am a worship pastor here at the church, and usually I'm at our Elgin campus. That's kind of my home campus, but it is always such a privilege to be down here in downtown. I really love it. I really love this community. It's a community that's like grounded and rooted in the gospel and the good news of Jesus and being shaped around the way of Jesus together. And let me be like the third one probably to welcome you today if you're just joining us. Every week, one of our practices is that we open up the scriptures together and we encounter God through his word. So if you have a Bible or a phone or a computer that works, go ahead and open that up to 1 Kings 19, which is where we're going to be this morning. We've been in a series on this character of Elijah through the book of 1 Kings for several weeks now, and we're going to be continuing that today. So let me pray to start off, and I just want to also mention and acknowledge this has been kind of a tough week for our city with the shooting in Highland Park, and then just over the weekend, and then all this other violence that's been going on in our city as well. And so these are all things that we want to bring to the Lord. These are all moments where we just go like, Lord, this is not how it's supposed to be. This is not how it should be. And would your kingdom come? And your will be done. And I want to just pray as we approach the word this morning, and also just pray over the families and the people who are involved in those tragedies this week. So would you pray with me right now? Lord Jesus, we come to you as the one who knows our every need and before we even ask, and who cares deeply about every tragedy and every situation that we walk through. And God, like I said, when things like this week happen, we just shake our heads and just go, this is just not supposed to be this way, Lord. And I know that you see and you hear from heaven the cries of your people. And I pray, Lord, that you would be present, that you would be comfort to the families who are experiencing deep pain and loss this week. I pray, Lord, that we would just see your kingdom come, that it's a big prayer, but Lord, that violence and things like this in our city would start to turn the corner. We wouldn't see this happen in the way it is. And Lord, eyes on you and all of this. We just, we know that you're a good God and you're a present God. And so we trust you in that. And we come to you with our requests and our hurts and our pains in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, 1 Kings 19. I'm going to read the whole story, and then we'll get into this. So go ahead and follow along. We're going to start right at the top in verse 1. Ahab told Jezebel everything that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "May the gods punish me and do so severely if I don't make your life like the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then Elijah became afraid and immediately ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba that belonged to Judah, he left his servant there, but he went on a day's journey into the wilderness. He sat down under a broom tree and prayed that he might die. He said, "I've had enough. Lord, take my life, for I'm no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. Suddenly, an angel touched him. The angel told him, "Get up and eat." So he looked, and there at his head was a loaf of bread baked over hot stones and a jug of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. Then the angel of the Lord returned for a second time and touched him. He said, "Get up and eat, or the journey will be too much for you." So he got up, ate, and drank. And then on the strength from that food, he walked 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mountain of God. He entered a cave there and spent the night. Suddenly, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of armies, but the Israelites have abandoned your covenant, torn down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are looking to take my life." Then he said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the Lord's presence." At that moment, the Lord passed by. A great and mighty wind was tearing at the mountains and was shattering cliffs before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire. The Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, there was a voice, a soft whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Suddenly, a voice came to him and said, same question again, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Same answer. "I've been very zealous for the Lord God of armies," he replied, "but the Israelites have abandoned your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are looking for me to take my life." And the Lord said to him, "Go and return by the way you came to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you are to anoint Hazael as king over Aram. You are to anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Mehola, as prophet in your place. Then Jehu will put to death whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, and Elijah will put to death whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, but I will leave 7,000 in Israel, every knee that has not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." This is the word of the Lord. So I want to start today by asking you a question. Have you ever felt disappointed by God? I know it can be like a little bit of an uncomfortable or awkward question to ask, but could you allow yourself to be honest for a second and just consider that? Have you ever been disappointed by God? Andy Squire is one of my favorite songwriters and lyricists. He writes this essay called "Have Mercy on God," and it says this: "My life with God has been a complicated one, and I can't really say the complications have been entirely my fault. I think a fair assessment would be that we've each allowed the other to experience at least some degree of disappointment in our friendship. I've misunderstood him. I'm pretty sure he's always understood me, but he hasn't necessarily been vocal about it. It's not easy being friends with people, and friendship with God is no different." It's a great essay, and his point is this: life is complicated, and friendship with God doesn't necessarily make it less complicated. You don't get a free pass from the troubles of the world just because you know Jesus. You know, some failures in my life, like, I know they're my fault. Like, stuff that I did, like, you know, in my 20s and high school, like, whatever, like, it was dumb, and I had to pay the dumb tax. I had it coming. I should have seen it coming, right? But then there are other times in my life where, like, I did all the right things, and I followed the Lord, and I thought I heard his voice, and I obeyed it, and then things didn't turn out like I thought they were going to. You know, or maybe I had, like, this expectation of something that was going to be this amazing thing, this great work for God, and then it just didn't work out that way. When things like that happen, there's a huge letdown. Do you know that feeling? Like, imagine, like, you know, you're going to plant a church, and there's vision, and there's answered prayer and provision, and people are coming to the Lord, and then something happens and the whole thing collapses. Or, like, think of, like, your wedding. You know, you're there at the altar, your marriage vows, you're in love, but 10 years in, the grind of life has taken its toll and your marriage has become cold, and you're like, this isn't really what I thought I was signing up for. You know? Or, like, your small business, that you're going to make all this money and give it away and do all this good for the community, and then, you know, the economy hits, COVID hits, and you have to shut your doors. You know, your kids, you do all the right things. You take them to church, you take them to youth group, you teach them the Bible, and then they grow up and go to college and they walk away from Jesus. And there's this letdown. You just go, like, what happened, Lord? That's not how it was going to go. I did everything right, but it turned out wrong. So what should we expect from God? How does God respond to these moments in our lives when we become a little bit disoriented in our relationship to God? See, what we see in the story is a personal portrait of a prophet who had a major letdown in his life. We're going to take this in two parts today. I want to cover, like, think of it as two halves. I want you guys to stay with me. First, we're going to look at what the story tells us about what it looks like to actually walk with God and what kinds of things we should expect over our journey with God. And then secondly, we're going to specifically look at how does God respond to our discouragement in those moments, okay? Because the story gives us a lot. So the first thing I want to talk about is just what does it look like to walk with God? When you approach the Bible, it's important to know what you're reading, okay? The Bible is a library of books, has different genres, different authors. It's from God, written by men, as they're carried along by the Holy Spirit. That's 2 Peter 1:21. And the Bible, most importantly, is a unified story that leads to Jesus. Everything in the Bible is intentionally crafted to lead to the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Okay, and in this unified story, there are certain themes. It's like a musical riff that happens over and over again. Okay, I'm a guitar player, and so I can relate to musical riffs. That's why I'm using this analogy. But like one of the best guitar intros of all time is When You Were Young by The Killers. If you know it, you know it. Fight me on that, that's not one of the best guitar riffs of all time. If you play Guitar Hero, you know what I'm talking about, okay? So when that song hits and that intro hits and there's that riff and then it comes back after the chorus and then it comes back after the bridge and it comes back later in the song, every time that riff happens, there's some variation on it, but it's reestablishing what the main, like, yes, the main point of the song is, okay? And maybe that analogy is helpful, but that's kind of how the Bible is. There's these riffs that happen, these themes that happen, and they happen over and over again by different authors in different places as they're carried on by the Holy Spirit. And the authors of the Bible were profoundly intentional in how they crafted these narratives. The story is never just the story, but the story is intended to tell us truths about God and about ourselves. And often the story, by the very way it's structured, is communicating something important. So there's a huge riff that's happening here in 1 Kings 19 that you, the reader, are meant to pick up on. Stay with me through this, okay? 1 Kings, as we've seen in previous weeks, has a series of crescendoing acts on the part of God where he's revealing himself in power as the one true God. And then there's this big showdown, and it's like he is God and none of the other gods are legit. And then there's this wilderness time, and then there's this meeting God on the mountain time. And as you're reading this, and you're knowing the story of the Bible, you should be going, wait a second, this sounds familiar. And the reason why is because this is the exact thing that we see in Israel's story in the book of Exodus. In fact, I did my best with a little PowerPoint chart here. I'm going to just go through this, but if you look at the story of Moses in Israel and you look at the story of Elijah, Yahweh reveals himself in power, Yahweh reveals himself in power. Pharaoh pursues, Jezebel pursues. Wilderness wandering. Provision of manna, water, provision of food and water. Meets with God at Sinai. Speaks and passes by the cave. Sends him out. We're supposed to pick this up as we're reading this story. Now, why does this matter? Why are these stories set side by side in this way? Like as I mentioned, these narrative structures in the Bible are carefully crafted to communicate theological truths to us. And one of the things that I see is that in these stories and several other places where this riff appears throughout the scriptures, they give us somewhat of like an arc for our spiritual journey with God. It's like a mental map for what it looks like to walk with God over a lifetime. In other words, Elijah's journey is one that we all take with God. So Christianity, from the early writings of the Desert Fathers to Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress to Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, has had a long history of describing life with God as a journey. And for good reason. A journey has a destination, has curves in the road, signposts, pitfalls, people that we encounter along the way, and it's not momentary. It happens over a lifetime where progress is made and character is developed. And in this story, Elijah has just had an incredible experience with God on Mount Carmel. He courageously did what the Lord asked him. He stood up against a whole army of false prophets, and God shows up. And so he's ready for the revival of God's people. He's expecting big things, but it doesn't happen. And it's a huge letdown to him. And instead of people's hearts turning back to God, he becomes a wanted man. The leadership of Israel, who should have turned people's hearts back to God, places a target on his head, and he finds himself running for his life. So he gets depressed, discouraged, defeated. Even though logically he should be full of faith and not fear, his emotions are not paying attention to his logic. He starts responding to the voice of fear rather than the voice of the Lord. Now, is there anybody here who can't relate to that in some way? When things don't go as we thought, it gives way to fear, anxiety, discouragement. So you and I can have this subtle assumption. We can think that life should always be improving, that history is always progressing for the better, that a life lived well, if you're doing it right, is up and to the right. It's victory to victory. It's strength to strength. It's glory to glory. It feels like that should be the case. Or that maybe life with God is like some kind of cosmic vending machine where you put in, you know, the faith and then the blessing comes down. And you put in more faith and then the blessing comes down. And then you put in the faith and the blessing doesn't come down. And you're like, well, maybe I'm not putting in enough faith. I'm here to tell you today as clearly as I can, that's not what the scriptures teach about your journey with God. And if you have that expectation, then you might have the wrong mental map in mind. It's like if you type the wrong address on your iPhone, you shouldn't get upset when you don't end up at the place you wanted to. If you have the wrong mental map, you'll feel disappointed when it doesn't happen the way you expect. And setbacks become an obstacle rather than a necessary part of the journey. But what the Bible does show us is that the arc for the spiritual journey of faith looks something like this. These are affirmed by the stories in Scripture as well as the wisdom of centuries of men and women who have walked with the Lord over church history. This is like, generally speaking, things that we will experience in our journey with God. Moments where we do big things for the Lord that take courage. We experience a mountaintop, supernatural moment, tons of zeal and energy. We're doing things for God and God is actively showing up. It's exhilarating. And then you'll experience some kind of death or a letdown. There's resistance and opposition. Something goes wrong. They're real enemies to your soul. Anxiety starts to take root. You start responding to fear. You become susceptible to the lies of the enemy, discouragement, depression, and you can't see where God's at. Then there's a journey through the wilderness, a period of time where external fruit doesn't seem evident in your life. It's not like it was before. I remember the good days. It doesn't seem like that now. But from the outside and maybe even inside, it feels like a failure to you. It feels like, where is God? But God is doing something significant beneath the surface of your life. And then God speaks to the inner places. He breaks the silence, but it's not in the same way that you experienced previously. We learn to hear God in the quieter places of our inner lives. We encounter him in a new way. It's a more contented interaction with God, one that is not dependent on a constant spiritual high. The silence teaches us to hear God in the everyday places of our lives. And then finally, a renewed perspective. God sends us out, and we walk with increased perspective and greater maturity, that life is not about us, but we are a part of God's greater story. So think about your own life with God for a second. Can you relate to the arc of this story? If you do, then you know that when you feel disappointed, it doesn't have to shake your faith or your trust in God, because we know that this is just a part of what it means to walk with God. We know that God doesn't always do things the way that we would. It also means that if you're in a season of wilderness, you're in really good company. Every single mature follower of Jesus that I know, man or woman, has experienced a season of wilderness in their life. It's the very way that God cultivates maturity in you and I. That's another teaching for another time. We'll save it for some other week. Okay, so are you guys with me so far? Yes. Okay, so that's the first half. Elijah's journey is one that we all take with God. Okay, now we're going to get to part two. Because even if we understand all this, it doesn't change the fact that we're going to experience discouragement in life. There will be times when you will feel the fear and anxiety, where you won't be able to prevent like the wave of negative emotions that are coming your way. So let's keep this personal for a minute. God doesn't meet Elijah's expectations. He doesn't always meet ours either, which can leave us feeling disoriented or disappointed with God. So the question is, how does God respond to people who are discouraged? And so that's where we're going to spend the rest of our time today. And I want you to jot down three things, if you're taking notes, that we see here in this text in 1 Kings 19. Number one, God cares. God cares. Number two, God engages. And number three, God redirects your perspective. Okay, so look back at 1 Kings 19, and let's start in verse 3. I'm going to reread this part of the text. Elijah became afraid and immediately ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba that belonged to Judah, he left his servant there. He went on a day's journey into the wilderness. He sat down under a broom tree and prayed that he might die. He said, "I've had enough. Lord, take my life, for I'm no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. Suddenly an angel touched him, and the angel told him, "Get up and eat." Then he looked, and there at his head was a loaf of bread baked over hot stones in a jug of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. Then the angel of the Lord returned for a second time and touched him. He said, "Get up and eat, or the journey will be too much for you." So he got up, ate, and drank. Then on the strength of that food, he walked for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mountain of God. So Elijah is a wanted man. He's like the Jedi running from the First Order, for all you Star Wars people out there. He runs out to the wilderness by himself. It's about 90 miles from where he was down to the wilderness where he went, which is a long ways. He leaves the servant, and he goes by himself in the wilderness, and he gets there, and he's so at the end of his rope. He is so emotionally spent that his only response is, "Just kill me now, Lord." All he can do is just collapse under a tree, and he falls asleep. When he stops running and he surrenders to sleep, God shows up. Elijah isn't asking for it. He's not looking for it. He's at his lowest moment. But because God cares, God shows up. And that's the first thing I want you to take away here. When you're at the end of yourself, God meets you with grace. When you get to the end of your rope and you're asking God, "God, what is it that you want from me?" Who you believe God to be in those moments really matters. And I'm here to tell you that God's default posture towards your discouragement is not anger, frustration, indifference. But his posture towards you, and this is how he's revealed himself in Scripture, throughout Scripture, his posture towards you is mercy. He meets you with grace. "God, what do you want from me? I want you to know that I love you." Exodus 34:6. Yahweh is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love and truth. Psalm 34:18. The Lord is near the brokenhearted. He saved those crushed in spirit. 1 Peter 5, verse 7. Cast all your cares on him because he cares about you. God cares for Elijah in two ways. He cares for us in this way too. He cares for Elijah's whole person in the present. So we are not just spiritual people. By design, we are embodied creatures, is the word. So like, we live and move and breathe in a physical world that God made and created us to live and move and breathe in. So physical care matters. Food, water, sleep. And by providing these things for Elijah, God is acknowledging his humanity. And he's meeting Elijah's very human need. I had a pastor that used to tell me, sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is take a nap. What we see here is an appreciation for the simple grace of life. Food, water, sleep. If you're depressed, start with the basics. Eat well. Drink water, exercise, put down your devices. Learn to have an eye and receive the simple graces of life. If we keep looking for highs and don't find them, we'll feel low. But God's desire for us is contentment. And we do this, we cultivate gratitude. the simple things that he's given us. Secondly, God reminds us of his provision in the past. The story of God providing food and water supernaturally to Elijah was a very familiar one to him, because he was also in wilderness in 1 Kings 17, two chapters earlier, and God miraculously provided food and water by these ravens that were like bringing him food. And the same God that was feeding Elijah with the ravens previously, also when like he was at the top of his game, was also providing for him now when he was at his lowest moment, when he had nothing to give. The same God was providing for him in the present. And we need to learn to remind ourselves of the faithfulness and goodness of God that we have seen. One of the most practical ways that we can do this, and I'm a journaling guy, I journal my prayers. There's something actually physical about writing it out that's really helpful to me. And one of the best practices, though, that you can do is to actually write out the ways that you've seen God be faithful in your life, and then turn those back into a prayer. Guys, this is like 101, super practical. But like, if you're anything like me, like I'm someone who has battled depression for a lot of my adult life. This is a practice that helps me every time, to cultivate gratitude, to remember the faithfulness of God, and speak it over my life and pray it back to him. And I would encourage you to do the same. David in Psalm 42 is another guy who battled depression. He says, "Why, my soul, are you so dejected? Why are you in such turmoil? Put your hope in God, for I will still praise him, my Savior and my God. I am deeply depressed. Therefore, I remember you from the land of Jordan and the peaks of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep and the roar of your waterfalls, all in of your breakers and billows have swept over me. The Lord will send his faithful love by day. His song will be with me in the night, a prayer to the God of my life." One reason you may be discouraged is that you don't remember. Remember what God has done in your life, and remember that he is the same God now. Second thing, God engages. God cares, God engages. Look at verse 9. "Suddenly the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' He replied, 'I've been very zealous for the Lord God of armies, but the Israelites have abandoned your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets. I alone am left. They're looking for me to take my life.' So God says, 'Go out and stand on the mountain in the Lord's presence.' And in that moment, the Lord passed by. A great and mighty wind was tearing after the mountains and was shattering the cliffs before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind was an earthquake. The Lord wasn't in that. After the earthquake, there was a fire. The Lord wasn't in the fire. After the fire, there was a voice, a soft whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Suddenly a voice came to him and said, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' 'I have been very zealous for the Lord God of armies,' he replied, 'but the Israelites have abandoned your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they are looking to take my life.'" So Elijah went to Horeb, to Mount Horeb, to meet with God, because he had a complaint. He had a protest. Okay, another name for Horeb, like it's the same exact mountain, is Mount Sinai. Like Mount Sinai from Exodus, the one that Israel goes out on, Ten Commandments, the whole thing. It's where God establishes his covenant with his people. And so Elijah has come back there because he's looking for answers. The amazing thing is when he gets to Horeb, God actually speaks first. God leads with a question. "Elijah, what are you doing here?" God often leads with questions, not because he doesn't know the answer, but because he is inviting your relational engagement with him. God is a God who is deeply invested in relationship with his people. And so God will lead with questions to invite engagement. I think of Genesis 3, Adam and Eve eat the fruit, realize they're naked, feel shame, run and hide. God comes and he says, "Where are you?" Not because he doesn't know where they are, but because he is inviting relationship. He's inviting confession. He's inviting dialogue. Jesus, Mark 10, with the blind man, says, "What do you want from me?" Not because he doesn't know, but because God knows that it's really important to be able to voice your heart's cry. It's really important to be able to voice the things that are in the deepest parts of you. And he knows that it's really important that you're able to do that before him. So the point is, your disappointment is an invitation to engage with the living God. Your disappointment is an invitation to engage with the living God. So what's Elijah's complaint here? What's driving his discouragement? We see it right here in verse 10. "I've been zealous for the Lord God of armies. The Israelites abandoned your covenant. They torn down the altars. They killed everyone else. I alone left. They're looking to take my life." He says it twice. You know, God's decisive victory against the prophets of Baal now seems on the edge of extinction. What was a consuming fire coming down from God now seems like an ember. "I'm doing everything you asked, God. It's not working. And now I'm the only one left." So, God gives him an object lesson. "Hey, Elijah, remember Moses in this very spot when I came down on this mountain with fire, with earthquake? Elijah, the way I'm going to show up right now isn't the same way that I showed up before. I am doing something different." If you're here today and you feel disoriented in your relationship with God, I have one word for you that I want you to hold on to. Engage. The temptation that you will experience when you feel disappointment is to walk away. When you hit real obstacles, you'll be tempted to conclude that God doesn't care or isn't good. You'll conclude that he isn't really there, this whole thing's just made up anyway, and just turn your attention to other things. "I tried God, it didn't work. I'm just going to bury my confusion and move on with my life," and walk away. You and I all know people who have done this. Like, maybe you're sitting here and you've done this yourself. Friends, real engagement with anything in life begins with unfiltered honesty. And in order to engage, you have to bring your complaint before the Lord. So my question then is, do you have a protest for God? Because God of the Bible is not freaked out by your protests. He's inviting you to engage relationally by bringing your whole self to him. He's asking you, "What are you doing here?" See, I found that God's not as concerned with the right thing as much as he is with the real thing. He doesn't want the right answer, he wants the real answer. And as long as we're only bringing our best selves to Jesus, we're never going to allow him to do the deep work in our true selves that he's actually wanting to do. But when we bring our complaint to the Lord, we should be prepared for him to respond, because he will. And he does, here with Elijah. So we see that in verse 15. "The Lord said to him, 'Go and return by the way you came to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you're to anoint Hazael, king of Aram. You're to anoint Jehu. You're to anoint Elisha. Jehu will put these guys to death. Elisha will put these guys to death. I will leave 7,000 in Israel. Every knee that has not bowed to Baal and every mouth that has not kissed him.'" So Elijah's protest, "God, I'm the only one left. There's no one else in all of Israel who's faithful." And the reality is that just because he couldn't see what God was doing doesn't mean that God wasn't doing something. His own experience had blinded his perspective, and he had become the center of his own story. So God redirects his perspective. Elijah was a part of a bigger story, God's bigger story, which God had already planned provision for. he tells him to appoint the people after him who will carry the torch forward. And not only that, that there are 7,000 other people in Israel that God has prepared that are going to be faithful to Yahweh. You see, the story of God is going to continue even beyond the reach, ministry, and life of Elijah. God has resources that Elijah has no idea about. And Elijah has a choice. And we have a choice too. You can remain bitter, or you can choose to embrace the story that is about more than me. The way out of discouragement is to reorient yourself in the bigger story of God. Guys, this is one of the great needs of our increasingly independent, individualistic, and deeply lonely generation. We need to find ourselves in a greater narrative. Relevancy, or the drive to meet a perceived need, is no longer enough. Millions of dollars are spent by companies and advertisers and algorithms every day to be relevant, to convince you that you are the most important part of the story and that you should, in fact, you deserve to have everything that you want out of life. And after a while of being saturated and soaked by a cultural environment like this, even as followers of Jesus, these assumptions can start to get into our bones and play out into ways that we don't even realize. The problem is, the more the story is about me, the more the story is about you, the smaller and the more depressing the story becomes. But God, in his mercy, is going to challenge your perceptions. He will not allow you to live your life for yourself, which is exactly why he breaks these expectations in our lives. The story of God is bigger than you. The story of God is more than me. The liberating truth of the gospel is that the story does not begin or end with you. But rather, as Colossians 1:20 says, through Christ, God is reconciling everything to himself, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. The story of God is the story of his redeeming the world that he made to himself, with the end of bringing heaven and earth together as one, just as it was in the beginning. And he has invited you and me to be participants in that story. The reason why God has called you, met you, saved you, sacrificed his one and only son for you, and made you a new creation is rooted and fastened in God's redemptive mission and purpose in the world. So the purpose for your life and the trajectory of your life with God and the hope that your future rests on is so much more than this moment or this circumstance in your life. It's more than this time and space that we're in right now in history. But rather, the story that the Bible is telling us is how God is reconciling a world that has rejected him to himself through the person and work of Jesus Christ. And that Jesus gave himself as a substitute for our sins, saving us from the wrath of God that we deserved. And after he died, he was resurrected and promises new life to everyone who would put their hope in him. God is doing things all the time that you and I are not aware of. The story of God is so much more than me. So my challenge to you today is this. Do you feel discouraged? Find yourself in the story of God. Remember that God has invited you into his story, that he has crafted a purpose and a trajectory for your life that's to join in the mission that he's already doing in this world. And he wants to reorient your perspective today. So I was preparing for this talk a couple of days ago, and this is the most basic of analogies, but it really stood out to me, so I'm going to share it. I have a 4-year-old daughter, and her name's Esther, and she's literally just like, if you could put sunshine and capture it in a like 4-foot human, like that's her. Like, she's just awesome. And I was prepping for this teaching, and I told Esther that we were going to have a snack at some point, and she came up the stairs, and she was looking for a snack, but it was already, like, lunchtime. So I'm like, honey, we're not going to have a snack right now. and just the meltdown that happened. The expectation that she had that she was going to get, I don't know, it was like pirate's booty or something from Trader Joe's. She's on the bottom of the stairs just bawling because she just wanted a snack and she didn't get a snack. And so I called her up to the top of the stairs and said, Esther, come here. Come sit on my lap. What's the matter, honey? I wanted a snack. And you said I could have a snack, and I don't have a snack. Look, honey, I'm going to go downstairs and make lunch right now. Would you like to come join me make lunch? I have a plan for the day. I know what's going to happen. The reason why we're not getting a snack right now is because we're going to do lunch. Would you like to join me in that? As simple as an analogy that is, sometimes in your relationship with God, it's helpful to just bring it down to the most basic, like, human level. I just saw a picture of life with God in that. I want a snack. Takes you up on his knee. Let's have lunch. Will you go help me make it? And if you don't leave today feeling like everything is resolved, I want you to know that's okay. Because the story is bigger than the moment that you're in. God is going about the work of redeeming all of your life, every single thing, over your lifetime, because of his love for you in Jesus Christ. And everything that you need for your journey with God has been provided by the grace of Jesus Christ. So when you're discouraged, he'll meet you where you are. He'll redirect your perspective. What he does want to do is minister, heal, sustain you, and assure you of his presence. What he has given is the Holy Spirit, who heals, comforts, sustains, and speaks. What he has provided is a church, a community that's rooted in the good news of Jesus and shaping our lives around the way of Jesus. And the way God will minister to you is through the brothers and sisters in Christ he's put around you in this room. And I think it's really important to know, if you're battling discouragement, engage. Allow people to come alongside you. Allow people to remember, help you remember the faithfulness of God in your life. So we're going to stop and we're going to close here today. And at the close of our gathering, though, I want to create some space just for that to happen. One of the things I really firmly believe is that when we come and we gather as a body, that the God through his Holy Spirit is active and has a real like ministry to everyone here. In other words, I really believe that the Holy Spirit speaks today. And if you would say, yes, that's me, I'm feeling discouraged, I'm feeling burnt out, I'm feeling disoriented, I'm feeling depressed, I'd love to be able to have some people pray over you, pray with you, and allow some time for the Holy Spirit to just minister to your heart, because I think that's one of the reasons why that you've come here today. And so we're going to do that. Our worship team is going to play a song here at the end. But if that's you and you'd like to receive prayer, please come up front and do that. And we'll have some people who would love to just talk for a minute, pray with you, and encourage you today. And let me pray. And then we're just going to move into a time of just prayer here together. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for everything that we see. You know, there's just so many layers, God, to the scriptures. It's a lifetime of study and meditation, and we could just talk for hours about all the things that you've done in these stories. And Lord, there's so much that you're doing even now, even today. Truth is, Lord, that we live in a culture and a society that is pretty burnt out right now, easily can become pretty cynical or guarded, and God, may it not be so with you. May we learn to engage you in the honest and the deep places of our lives. May we learn to believe that you're a God who cares, and may our perspective just be redirected as we find ourselves in your bigger story today. So Lord, we love you, and we just want to respond to your goodness as we close. In Jesus' name, amen.